welcome everyone to another episode of the Charlie West Wrestling Show. I'm here once again with Tony and the Supreme Ozzy Blaze, and we're here to discuss today the top 10 best catchphrases in wrestling. So just like any phrase, any line that wrestlers like to say again and again and again, like wrestlers
tend to do.
They tend to say a lot of the same
stuff. And then put it on t-shirts.
Absolutely. That's what t-shirts are for.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, does anyone want to go first?
I'll go first with number 10.
Okay.
It's good to go first with number 10.
Yeah, I was thinking starting with 7, to be honest.
What was your number 3?
Yeah. Number 10.
We talked about that last time.
Well, we have fun and jokes here, but if I can just be serious for a moment. Lance Storm, if I can just be serious for a moment, is my number 10. Because I remember as a kid hating it. And it's just it just stuck with me. Like whenever someone says, can I be serious? Like, I'm always like, ha! Lance Storm used to get us with that every time. And he used to like come to the ring. And when he first started doing it, like, it wasn't that old, but it did get over. It got very old.
I think he's probably the most underrated Canadian wrestler of all time.
Hmm. Yeah, I love Lance anyway.
I like his old ECW stuff.
Yeah.
The Primetime Players.
Is that what they're called? Primetime Players? Something like that.
No.
Him and Just Incredible. What were they called?
They weren't the Primetime. Primetime Players was Titus O'Neil and Darren Young.
They were called something like that.
Yeah. Right. But yeah, Lance Storm, if I can just be serious, I just remember that as a kid resonating. A bit like Right to Censor in this type thing. Like, I hated it that much, but now whenever I hear someone saying, like, you know, let's be serious, like, I always chuckle and think of Lance Storm, so that's why I put that one.
My number 10, you're gonna like it. It's way more positive. Hey yo. That's
hey,
it.
Yo.
You get two words. And you get two words over like that, and if people still say it, and if you hear that, you know who it is. You're thinking of Scott Hall.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, even when he passed away, like, on the Raw afterwards, like, Kevin Owens started his promo with Hey Yo, right?
And everyone knows what it means.
Yeah.
Like, how do you get that over? That's genius.
Hey Yo.
That whole thing, if you call that whole promo a catchphrase, you know, the survey?
Yeah.
Who's here to see WCW? That was great, too.
Mm.
All right, what do you got, Charlie?
Okay, so we said about getting two words over.
Yeah.
This one I also have is a two-word catchphrase.
Yeah.
It's one that I think there was a point where it would be higher, but I think it sort of got diluted over time, like, because there was a period where it was like a really impactful, it really meant something.
Okay.
And then it sort of was something that was building up to always being cut because you could only do it at a certain amount of time, which is, you're fired, Vince McMahon.
That's a good one. I forgot about that one.
Yeah. Because at the beginning, it was like, it was when they were legitimately kicking people out of the company, right? Like, he was firing people because they were leaving for other climbs or they were disappearing for a bit. But
I just love the way he used to say it, like, you're fired.
And that's how crazy this guy, he went so into it, right?
Yeah.
Like, that's what you gotta give Vince. That's a good one.
No, it was. Just, I think in the past 5 years or so, it became a bit more of a parody of itself as a phrase.
When
he first started doing it, it was really like, it meant something, right?
Yeah,
it was
good.
Like, oh, shit, they're actually fired.
That's a good one. My number 9 is another two-word catchphrase.
Okay.
While we're on it. And it's just a classic, oh yeah,
good one.
Buck off in the big time.
Because everyone,
oh yeah,
everyone still does it. Like, if you do that to someone, they know you're talking about Savage.
And if you mention Macho Man, the first thing people do is go, oh yeah,
right, exactly. Yeah, good.
Love it.
I love it too.
It's a great one.
My number 9 is to be the man, you gotta beat the man. Because I think that's such a simple catchphrase.
Yeah.
That Flair used for years. Right? And if you just think about it, if you're ever, you know, where Flair was, right? If you want to get to the top, you got to beat Flair.
Yeah.
Right? It made, when he was saying it, I think it made matches more, it made it feel like a bigger deal to get a chance to beat Flair.
Yeah.
No, even like later on in his career, around like the Twilight end, when he wasn't like a champion or whatever, he still used it as like a stepping stone for
other
wrestlers that were coming in. They were like, well, You're new here. You've to be the man. You've got to beat the man, and like that set up matches and feuds and stuff. Still, so yeah, it's a good one. That
look, it feels like a phrase that comes from somewhere else, right? It feels like a phrase that has existed in like sport or competition for a long, long time, and he's coined it for himself.
Possible.
As opposed to,
I'm not sure.
It may well be, but
I like that one.
Yes, mine is going like completely the opposite direction of being like very modern.
Yeah,
it's probably one of the more modern ones on my list, and it's one where, again, it's part of a tag team where they were so over for a short period of time.
Mm-hmm.
So it probably seems corny now because we're back to where they are, like, forgotten remnants of a bad time, but the...
this is going to be bad.
It's the... there's only one word to describe you, and I'm going to spell it out for you. S-A-W-F-T. The Enzo and Cass. But that was so big. It was so charismatic at that point. Like, it's difficult now, because Enzo Amore especially is such a joke now. You forget that, like, for about a year, that tag team was one of the hottest things out there, and it was all about their charisma and all about their catchphrases. Yeah.
Well, they could have been, if they'd have lasted longer, they'd probably still be doing that, like...
Yeah, they'd be doing that. Yeah.
So they came up with, like, Cup of Haters and all that stuff that was, like, on T-shirts for... Yeah. Certified G and all that stuff. Like, they were like the New Age Outlaws of. Like,
they really were the When I first saw them, I'm like, oh, these guys. Are...
Because
a little bit with the Sean Diesel vibe too.
Yeah. It basically is a take on the "I've got two words for you." Right?
Yeah, it kind of is. Okay. What are we at now?
Number eight.
Too sweet.
That's classic.
Yeah, like to make those two words, the hand gesture, and everyone still does it in wrestling now. Like the Bullet Club fucking does that. Right? Like, that's...
You fucking do it.
I do it, yeah. It's iconic.
Yeah. It's got Finn Balor and AJ Styles doing it on Raw. Like, yeah. Whenever they see each other in their little...
Right, right. And it gets a massive pop. Yeah, yeah. All they have to do is do that. Yeah, exactly.
Crowd goes insane.
And just the way they used to do it in the NWO. The NWO was just too sweet. The whole crowd is doing it with them. Classic. Fuck you, Charlie. Don't look at me like that.
I'm just... You know, I understand. You're just one of those people.
Yeah. So, my number eight is probably a newer one. It's Chris Jericho, and there's loads from Jericho you could use, but the one that I found like the best recent one is "You Just Made the List." Like that, he took like this simple like thing that was stupid and silly, and he just made it into like Chris Jericho does with a lot of
most
stuff.
Over thing they had.
Yeah, like so over for a while. Like everyone was sat waiting for him. He's like, you know what happens to people who don't get my coffee right? You just made the list.
It was like the list of Jericho. The list stuff Jericho, like that.
That whole one that was and then they coined it into like one of the greatest like modern like swerves or whatever with the friendships and the list
that was
of
pretty
KO.
Obvious.
It was obvious, but
it was done well.
They did it, if we ever do like a like favorite non wrestling segments in wrestling, Festival of Friendship is
that was such a great
possibly in there.
Okay.
Jericho just made the list his for months.
Yeah,
and it was just one of those things. Even when he came back after a while being out, like there was still with Elias, he had that whole promo where it was like everyone was just waiting. He's like, say it, and he's like, you just made the list, and everyone just like went insane for it.
It probably might be his best catchphrase. Actually.
I toyed with like a bunch of Jericho ones because he's got like never ever and stuff like that.
I
like when he was like, I'm the best in the world at what I do.
Yeah.
But that's it's not the best catchphrase of all time.
The list of Jericho is probably.
I'm just glad you didn't mention Bubbly.
Let's see what kind of bullshit Charlie has now for number eight.
My number eight is I think one of two that are still going right now in wrestling.
Okay.
And it's an intro one. It's one that's used at the start of like before the entrance music kicks in. It's like to pump up the crowd, know these people are here. And it's the like saying the name of the town. It's like New York, don't you dare be sour. Oh. Clap for your world famous 11-time champs. And feel because it really just it highlights like the New Day, what they are, what they're all about. It builds a crowd. Yeah. It's a really cool entrance.
Yeah, that's a good entrance. Yeah. Big E is pretty good in it. He got to do that Tyson Fury Wilder thing based on like his that was really good hype promos. He's good at hype. Yeah.
Yeah, because it hypes people up. People
know exactly I was watching that boxing match with a bunch of people and everyone's like, who the fuck is that guy? Yeah. I'm like, oh, he's the wrestling champ right now. Yeah, I was like, I never even heard of him.
But yeah, he is good at like that whole hype thing, so. And it's only number eight on your list, so.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. I didn't think of that.
Seven.
You want to go first, Tony?
I'll go first. All right. Because my number seven is classic Steve Austin one, and that's the bottom line.
Stone Cold said so.
Literally, you say, and that's the bottom line, and any wrestling fan's gonna come up.
Just didn't put it on my list. Like it was honorable mention. I had that one too. I just like other ones. I think because Austin 316. Hell yeah, he had so many. It was just
what?
Except that one.
I
hate it. And can you believe a guy who did so much for the wrestling business came up with that, and it's still a problem.
It happened on SmackDown just before we taped this. Like Logan Paul got a bunch of watch chants. Like, But yeah, and that's the bottom line is one of my favorites, because he's just like, he's just how he end, he can end anything with it. Like,
yeah.
Shut anyone down during a promo, and just like, and that's the bottom line, and like,
cause Stone Cold said so, and then everyone's going,
yeah. It's like, even if he's fucking up a promo, he can still get that, and that's the bottom line.
Yeah, that's a good point. Still like, if you've ever cut a promo in an arena, in a ring, you know, sometimes you get lost if you have something like that to go to. It's
having that end like thing that will just end your promo
and get a pop.
Yes,
that's a good one. My number seven is, you know, I think, I know you said he's a shit talker. Bret Hart did come up with the best there is, the best there was, and the best there ever will be. It's you might not like it, but it's still memorable. Yep. It was that one thing, like, when Bret became the champ, he started saying that, and it made you be like, okay, he is the best. Okay, he's on another level. And how, it's not original to say you're the best, but it usually gets a reaction from people.
Yeah, no, it has. There's definitely, like, there's intensity to it. It's something, again, like, 9-year-old me or 10-year-old me was there going, like, seems a fair point.
And when he was a heel, it worked just as well, too. Maybe arguably better.
I'm not the biggest Bret Hart fan as far as his, like, speaking is concerned, but that line, that is a great line.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
It's a fantastic line. Like, it is, I'll give credit where credit's due there. Hmm. Brilliant.
Thank you, Tony. Good job. Might have been a problem between us if you said it was that. Buried it that.
No, I wouldn't bury it. I wouldn't bury that line. That's I've used that one before, like in like joking arguments and stuff, and like pretend promos and that. Yeah. I've used that one.
Okay.
So I like that one.
So you have no problem with that line. Just every other line he ever spoke in a wrestling
ring. Yeah. No, Bret had
except
some
when he
good stuff.
When he was shitting on America, that was funny.
Yeah, he had some good stuff. Yeah, he had some good stuff, Bret. But like overall, I just didn't like the Bret Hart cadence.
Right.
Maybe you just don't like the way Canadians speak.
It's possible. They have a weird way of speaking.
Hey.
Yes.
Number six.
No, I got my number seven, thank you very much. Seven. Okay, so my number seven is the...
Off the rails already, Tony.
Yes. So my number seven is... I think it counts as a catchphrase, even though it's about 6-7 lines long. But the guy did say it over and over again.
Yeah, okay, I get some of those.
And it's one where you might need to help me out because I know it and I like it, but I can never remember the...
All right.
It's the limousine riding...
Jet flying, yes, wheeling, dealing, son of a gun.
Alligator shoe wearing.
Yeah, I like that one too. I didn't make my list, but it was like, I went for Be the Man.
Yeah.
Be the Man, you gotta beat the man, but I like that one too.
But I love that because he would reel that up, and like I say, it's this thing of like
go crazy too, right?
And like getting a catchphrase over that is basically a monologue. And saying the same monologue again, and people are not just we get it, you're doing that, you're doing no.
But
you're
when
always...
he would start doing it, like limousine ride and jet fly, ooh, and he would get he'd take his clothes off,
he'd
sometimes
start elbowing his jacket, stuff like that.
I honestly think Flair's the best promo of all time because he had catchphrases mixed with speaking, and he could be crazy. He could also, when he was being a babyface, he could just talk and get sympathy. Like, Terry Funk broke my neck. Flair was a magician. Absolute magician.
He could do almost anything, both in and out the ring.
Right. Very and easy. Almost die in the ring, too.
Yes, he might still.
Yeah, I think he wants to.
Yes.
Where are we at now?
We're now at number six.
Number six, okay.
What's your number six?
My number six?
It doesn't matter what your number six is.
Fuck! Damn it! That's a shoe. I don't know how I fell for that.
Why doesn't it matter?
Because The Rock says, it doesn't matter. Always, nice. Every time as a kid.
I forgot about that
got
one.
Me, every time as a kid. It was more like just Coach, Cole, everyone. What is your name?
I can't believe you just
fucking got it. It doesn't matter what your name is. Like, every time. Like.
All right, my number six. I feel good saying this now after I just got worked with that. Cut the music! Rick Rude's whole intro promo. What I'd like to have right now is for all you stupid, fat, inner city sweat hogs to keep the noise down. What's that?
Sweat hogs.
He had so many. He would change it based on the town, you New York City scumbags, whatever, right? Just that whole. The whole Rick Rude promo from start to finish. It was basically the same all the time. I consider that a catchphrase.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I think when it's essentially the same thing, I think that's like the one I just did, right? Limousine riding.
Yeah, it would be in that category.
Yeah.
And I just, even when I watch it now, if I watch an old one, I think just
gets me every time.
It gets me every time.
And I always love that they always cut us like some like 80s or 90s woman with like a perm and glasses on in the crowd, just like.
And then all the guys are just screaming at him. Oh man, he was.
I'd take off my robe and show you what a real man looks like. And he had the body to.
And then the music would hit again when he was taken off the robe after.
Hit my music, like.
Yeah. He's a legend.
And he had like the body to go with that gimmick as well. Like, yeah. He was always like, never seen Rick Rude.
And the cheesy porn mustache.
Yep. Oh, he's brilliant.
All right, you're up, Tony.
No, he's not. What?
It's him.
Oh, sorry. I meant Charlie.
Being forgotten. So many times, you know. Luckily, sadly, I can't like filter this catchphrase in because I've never broken my neck. But whenever Kurt Angle would like suffix whatever he's saying and say like, and I did it with a broken freaking neck.
Yeah.
And it's just that thing of like it really hammers home that like not only am I good, I am so good that I'm better than you, and I don't even have a neck that works.
Like, I'm better than you, and you know it.
Yeah, imagine how good I would be if I didn't have that. Like it's just it really highlighted like the intensity and what that guy could bring to a ring at any one time.
If I can do an honorable mention, MJF's I'm better than you and you know it, it's not quite iconic level yet, but I think it's the one of the best ones in the modern era.
Yeah
that's one. Yeah, he's very good. I mean, yeah, I suppose with him it's whether he decides he wants to rely on catchphrases when he can always keep coming up with such new stuff all the time.
Right we'll see.
Okay, number five.
Five? Okay, mine's a repeat. Oh, yeah. Top five.
I'm annoyed that didn't come into my... It's because my head...
You forgot that one?
Well, because I don't...
You're the biggest Macho Man mark of all.
I know, but it's like... Because it doesn't... Those sort of things like that, like things like that, hey, yo, like, they didn't register as catchphrases.
It feels like you're speaking Korean.
Yeah. They didn't register as catchphrases to me. This guy. Like, they register as, like, just part of the speech, as opposed to a thing that's like...
You're going to hate my number one.
Like a thing that you put on a t-shirt, even though you probably put "oh yeah" or "hey yo" in the
t-shirt. It is. It's on his gear sometimes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ooh,
yeah. So those things just never clicked as being catchphrases.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay.
My number five is another. It's like a monologue, but it's the monologue that got me through like most of my early childhood, and it's just the "ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages, D Generation X, and New Age Outlaws."
Yeah.
Tag team champions of the world. The Road Dog, Jesse James, the Badass Billy Gunn. And then you had Billy with his two words.
You include the whole thing. The whole thing. Shit.
Fair enough.
Because it all was done every time. Without fail, it wasn't different. Apart from the number of championships. Like even when they came back and did that run where they won the belts, they were like, you're 6-time or 5-time tag team champions of the world. It's like...
And Billy Gunn's having a resurgence now somehow.
Yeah.
With another catchphrase.
Yeah, exactly.
Sizzly daddy ass.
And it's over, and it's great. Yeah.
Ah, yeah. But yeah, that whole thing, that whole spiel, I could probably just regurgitate.
I used to do that in high school. Yeah. I got kicked out of classes for doing doing it. I did the whole, are you ready? I did it to the teacher one time, and I got in trouble for that, but it's funny.
Yeah, I actually riffed on it at the most recent pub show we just did for one of the entrances to the matches. I'd be like, you know what, F it, people know this.
Yeah,
it's like, let's get ready to brawl. And
You should do that. You should keep doing that.
Yeah.
Okay, whose turn is it?
Did you do number five yet?
I did five,
Okay. Oh, yes. So my number five is back to classic wrestling.
Okay.
And it's one that I expect both of you will say at some point, which is Everyone's Got a Price. For the Million Dollar Man.
No, I don't have that.
No?
Nope.
Wow.
Nope.
And it is classic, isn't it?
Classic.
Yeah, good one.
He still does it classic Raws. Like,
Even when he does... Yeah,
is he dead?
No, he's still going.
It's hard to tell with those guys in that era.
He recently did a thing with Cameron Grimes in NXT. He gave him the Million Dollar Title.
He had
a Million Dollar Title feud.
He's that shaggy haired dude, right? Okay.
I don't know much about him. Grimes is great. He almost made my list with his catchphrase. His catchphrase is really, really good.
I can imagine that. I'd love that.
It's to the moon.
Oh. Yeah, okay. Put that to the trash. Okay, number four?
Yep.
What you gonna do, brother?
That's my number four.
Is it? It is.
What you gonna do?
That got me so hyped. And I was like, even though I wasn't like, I liked Savage more than Hogan, still gotta love that. And watching it, I think it ages well, too, as a classic...
Hmm.
thinking about how much money that guy makes saying that.
You can put anyone in it as well. What you gonna do when Hulk Hogan and the Macho Man run wild on you,
blah. Yeah, yeah, we would end. And again, it was the same thing. He could always end his promos that way.
Yeah.
Right? So even if he was saying some crazy, stupid shit, as soon as he hit that, you remember it as a great promo. There he is.
And it works heel and face, right?
Yeah.
It works heel and face.
No, I don't think he didn't say much.
Not real. In the NWO, he didn't. I don't think he said it too
much. I mean, he.
At the very beginning, he might have done it.
Yeah.
A bit just to try to get heat from it. Yeah. But, okay. Who's up? We had the same one.
So yeah, you had the same number four. Okay, so in the same way of that idea of a very charismatic person with a very charismatic gets you over, ends a phrase and people know exactly what they do. Like, if you want to bring heat to a crowd, okay, if you want to really bring heat to a crowd and really show that you are this heel that's better than everyone else.
I know what he's going to say.
There's nothing better than...
You're going to do it, aren't you?
Because I'm the Miz.
I knew it.
I'm awesome.
This is number four.
Number four.
Yeah, of all time. All the best wrestling catchphrases. Miz gets four.
I fucking knew it. I knew it the second you said.
I'm surprised he didn't put it two.
I was expecting it to be higher.
Well, Mr. Perkin, my number three is perfect. Perfect, because I really feel Charlie deserves this right now. Suck it! Miz sucks. Suck it!
No, Miz is awesome.
No.
Miz sucks.
And
suck it. What a great catchphrase that was. That got so many kids suspended from school in the 90s. In any way you want to, the crotch chop with it. If you want to do the got two words for you or are you ready, suck it. Fucking great.
That's fair. Number three?
My number three is a repeat. It's what I'd like to have right now. It's for all you fat, out of shape.
Oh, you had that one too. Hogs. Of course you did.
No, he's down.
I should. He's the biggest Rick Rude.
Well, I take my robe off and show you what a real man looks like.
Right.
Yeah, awesome. Rick Rude's just top tier.
Awesome.
Yeah. My number three is also a repeat. It's a repeat of you, though. Best there is, best there was.
You put that at number three?
Yeah, wow. Because I think that, despite the fact that when you watch Brett, now, and you watch him do promos, and it's, this same sort of just, I'm the hitman. I'm gonna sort of talk and not really say anything of any interest. The fact that he always ends it with that one promo, and, you sort of realize, if you just said that one line, people would think you're really good on the mic. Because that one line is really good, really intense. Yes. Even when Natalia came in, right? They tried to get her over with, elements of trying to...
Oh, really? I don't remember that.
I think when she first came in, she would sort of do some of that stuff and, do the sharpshooter and whatever else. But it's such a really good line, right? Yeah. Okay, so, Tony, how about number two?
Mine's a repeat. It's the limousine riding, kiss stealing... alligator shoe wearing
diamond ring wearing
it's so over that you get people in the NBA and NFL and stuff. Did you see that one? I think it was the NFL where they were in the locker room before a match and
doing all the Ric Flair stuff.
It's kiss stealing limousine riding.
I remember that though.
It's just a classic Flair line that's just
mm-hmm.
one of his best, that he gets himself all riled up and he's like does the flare bump and the elbow drops to his jacket.
My number two, this guy would have been great no matter what. But if it wasn't for this catchphrase, I don't know if he would have actually... He wouldn't have got to the level he got to as quick. If you smell what The Rock is cooking. That is one of the greatest catchphrases because that arguably made him. When he first started doing that and, his music, he's like, do you smell what The Rock is cooking? I loved how... When it was like that, opposed to... Yeah, I prefer the original one, but just to talk about smell what someone's cooking...
It makes no sense,
right?
What?
A lot of The Rock's catchphrases, don't...
Well, that makes sense if you smell what The Rock is cooking, if you know what I'm talking about.
That's a thing in Canada?
Is that like a catchphrase people used?
He said it, they were saying it at the University of Miami.
Right.
When he was there, people were saying it, and then he just made it.
Right. I didn't know if it was a real thing.
The Rock made it. The Rock made it famous.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, I guess guys on the football team were saying it back then, and then he just took it to wrestling. And I remember at first being like, what the hell? But then it just became cool.
Yeah, it is a great one. And it's that one that when it hits, it's like, if you smell, the crowd just pops.
Exactly.
Yeah.
What the Rock is cooking.
And if he didn't come up with that, do you think he obviously would have been good, but he wouldn't have got to that level as fast if he didn't come up with that one.
I reckon he definitely got him over with something like getting the crowd behind him. But that's the time he's doing the stuff like calling himself like the People's Champion, and he was like, the millions.
That was more
catchphrases.
But that was the first one, and that was the first one that put him in the main event.
Yeah. And it also has that like that Royal Rumble return factor of it, of like if you don't know he's about to turn up, and you just in 1 second you can hear that,
and the place goes crazy.
Yes,
the biggest pop you've heard.
Which has happened at many
wrestling. Exactly, it has the same. It has the same reaction as glass breaking. It has the same reaction as bum 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 banana. Like
what the fuck is that?
That's Hulk Hogan.
Ah, okay. I thought you were doing Fandango or something.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Fandango's on the same level
you
as... Only you would associate Fandango as being potentially on the same
level. Let's hear your number two.
My number two?
Yeah.
Iconics?
Do they have some iconic catchphrase?
They do. Actually, they have the phrase, iconic!
You didn't do that.
No, I didn't.
You know we wouldn't do your show anymore if you put that.
No, I have a what you're going to do. Hulk Hogan.
What you
gonna do? I was not sure whether I wanted to like also incorporate "Let me tell you something, brother," like at the start of it.
Yeah.
But the "What you're gonna do" is the main part.
Yeah, and the Hulk made a run wild on you.
Yes, that bit. Yeah,
good one. Okay.
So number ones.
Wanna go first, Tony?
Yeah, my number one is it's kind of a repeat, but I put like the whole spiel in of like it's time for another survey.
Really?
NWO.
Oh shit! I buried this story.
WCW. One more for the bad guys. Love it.
That's like, everyone. Yeah, right? But Hey Yo is involved in that too, right?
Like,
okay.
Every time that I hear that, like I'm like transported back to watching Nitro on like a Tuesday, because it was Tuesday in the UK when we watched it.
That's when I got it too.
Tuesday, Channel 5, like watching Nitro and just like. The NWO coming out and Scott Hall.
And that's your guy.
Hall was my guy. So it's just like, time for another survey. And the whole thing. Love it.
Hey, it was my number 10.
Yeah.
Yeah. But you can mix it up, right? Yeah, like, a lot of these, when I watch Nitro now, that's my favorite part. Probably is one of my favorites. Okay, my number one, you guys might think this is cheap, but if you go to any wrestling show, any indie show, no matter where you go, anywhere right now, you are going to hear at least a few times, woo,
woo.
That simple sound, right?
Yeah.
And that's never going to die in wrestling. Anytime someone does a chop or a figure four, any wrestler, how many people go, woo, woo, throughout the crowd?
It's the positive version of what?
I don't think I've been to a wrestling show that hasn't had a woo.
When I go to
small shows and stuff.
If you go when I went to WrestleMania like years ago, you could just I would sit in the crowd or even walking around the Sky Dome. If you just went, I did it a few times, woo, and you'd hear other people start doing it. It's like that. It's a wrestling fans connection to each other.
Yeah.
No, I can understand it. Like I say, because it is like the positive version of like the what chant.
So you count woo as a catchphrase?
Yeah, I would definitely.
I would. Yeah.
Says it all the time.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, hell, that's what also tried to get Charlotte over when she came in, right? That she does it as well now.
Okay.
It's because that's what WWE do when they bring in the kid of someone. It's like, be your parents.
Yeah, it doesn't usually work. Good thing Bray Wyatt didn't come out and try to be, like, a tax adjuster or something like that. Might have been more entertaining than The Fiend. That bugged me.
Yes.
Actually, at the last show at the university, during when they were doing chops, there was woos.
Yeah.
Yeah, in South Korea,
people are wooing South Korea.
For sure, exactly. So like, everywhere you go.
Yeah, it's an iconic thing that is just going to never die.
Yeah, I don't think it should. It's one of those wrestling, I don't know, wrestling trope or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, it's going to exist in the same way that people are going to repeat one fall whenever the person says this match is scheduled for one fall.
It's always
going to be part of it.
Yeah, exactly.
And I think if a crowd is not trolling a wrestler, then it's fine, right?
Yeah.
Like, things like what? Like, especially when someone's using their second language or something, it's like, don't be assholes. Like, if they're not very good, boo them, but don't sabotage a show. Woo never sabotages anything. Wormful never sabotages anything.
Yeah,
it's just
an
interaction that makes people part
of
the show.
So what bugs you when smarks do it to fuck with someone?
Yeah, exactly. It's like, why are you doing this? Like, especially when it's, like, to, like, a Cesaro or an Andrade or Nakamura, where it's like they're using their second language.
What?
And you're trying to.
Wow, Tony's on fire today. Did you be like Molly or something before this show? Like, what happened? You didn't give me any.
Oh my. Anyway,
all right. What's Charlie's number one?
My number one.
Like shrooms or something? Like, yeah. You're much better though. Like, it's good. Like, you do drugs before the show all the time, Tony.
I was waiting for the.
The official policy of the CW Wrestling Show is please do not do drugs before any show or event.
What?
God, nerd.
Anyway, my number one. You kind of alluded to this because when you had It Doesn't Matter and you had Do You Stand What The Rock Is Cooking, and we sort of alluded to the idea of like The Rock has got so many catchphrases.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
And my number one is kind of just The Rock.
What?
Like, because there is just the finally The Rock has come back to, or It Doesn't Matter. Like, there's just so many catchphrases that.
The Rock is you.
Yes.
I thought you meant The Rock.
No. Just like the catchphrases of The Rock.
Yeah,
like his catchphrase.
Cheap answer.
I had to pick one.
Yeah. Or put them in different spots then. Yeah. Break away? That's fucking cheap.
It's a great one, though. Shan, yeah. I'm going to take this.
I'll stick it up Shan your candy ass.
Really,
yeah, nice. We'll go
Rudy
Poo one,
candy ass.
The build-up to that one was great, though. It's like,
yes.
I admit he had so many great ones.
Yeah.
Turn that sumbitch sideways.
Yeah. Yeah. He could take anything of anybody's.
Charlie could take that list he has right there.
Shine it up real nice.
Turn it sideways.
Sideways.
And jump it straight up your Rudy Poo candy ass.
The Rock even got like maybe pie later. Over with his like
Poontang pie.
Yeah, do you like pie? Like,
yeah.
Everyone knew what he was talking about.
Yeah.
Do you like pie?
Yeah.
The Rock likes pie.
But I think compared to anyone else, just the ability to just consistently get catchphrases over. Like maybe Jericho comes close, but his
they're way worse.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The Rock got over with like wrestling fans. Jericho gets over with like AEW fans. So it's a slight difference.
There's some great Jericho catchphrases.
No, there are.
But like,
you just made the list, which was a great one. You. But yeah, that's fine. The Rock.
All right.
That didn't work. Anyhow, that's been our top 10. I know for me with this list, the biggest trouble was that I started with like 30 and had to get it down to 10. There's just so many
there. There's so many missing.
Yeah.
Like, holler if you hear me. Excuse me. That almost made my list because of the heat that you'd get from Excuse Me, because that's how great it is.
Yeah.
It's just a heat-seeking missile.
So
Taz had a decent one in ECW. They didn't have too many. He had Win If You Can, Survive If I Let You.
Yeah.
Beat Me If You Can, Survive If I Let You. I liked when Piper used to say, just when you think you got all the answers, change the questions. But like for it to be a catchphrase, not that many people would know right away that's Piper. Piper was just good on the stick.
Yes.
But did he have a catchphrase? Would be it, but.
And I think there were some that were good for like the promos and some that were good for like the crowd at the time. Like something like Edge and Christian, the 5 second pose. Where like we're gonna pose for 5 seconds. And
For the benefit of flash photography.
Yes, that one. Yeah. And like that really
so
pops.
Dated,
but it really pops like the live crowd, but it doesn't.
When I went to a house show in Toronto and they came out and they did it and they took off jackets or whatever and they had like New Jersey Devil, that was the team the Leafs were playing a lot back then. And like we just shit on them so bad, but they're Toronto boys. They knew what they were doing.
Yeah,
right.
So there's so many catchphrases out there. So obviously, let us know what you think we forgot. Please like, comment, subscribe, ding bells, all the things, and we will see you next time on the CW Wrestling Show. Thank you very much for watching. Goodbye.